Hi, I'm Dev, and I'm a dev. I'm also a DevRel. Let's talk about the iceberg of authentication. If you're building applications these days in a competitive market, there's some really high expectations from the part of your users, especially when it comes to auth. Most of it has to do with wrapping application security concerns around a delightful and intuitive user experience. And in case you didn't notice, there's a lot of stuff. There's passwords, there's OAuth, there's email verification, multi-factor, passkeys, bot detection, session management, and so on. A lot of stuff. And yes, the users are expecting it, because everyone else is doing it. And you're not going to stand out in the market by offering less capabilities to your users. So let's go down this list for a bit. Passwords are the easy one, right? Well, unfortunately, there's a lot more to passwords than don't store them in plain text. Did you know that the US government has a department called the National Institute of Standards and Technology that very specifically outlines how to handle passwords, or as they call it, memorized secrets? Turns out, having a combination of uppercase and lowercase characters and digits and symbols, also called the LUDS requirement, is a bad idea according to their research. Passwords end up being too predictable or too difficult to memorize, which means they end up on sticky notes. On top of that, we also need to make sure that the passwords haven't already been leaked before. And a majority of users out there don't use password managers that help them with these use cases. The Open Web Application Security Project, or OWASP, provides recommendations on how to handle passwords on top of the NIST guidelines. They recommend using the ZXCVBN library for password complexity testing and the Have I Been Pwned service to check for breached passwords. But this is not limited to new user creation. Every time a user signs in or changes their password, we should be checking if the password has leaked since the last time we checked. Speaking of, NIST also has a giant section on guidelines on how to handle forgot password cases that I don't think I have the time to get into here. NIST also has a section on how to store passwords securely. And as you would expect, it involves using a one-way hashing function, which is different from encryption, which is both ways. Hashing is really slow but necessary because we have to assume that these hashes will leak, and we have to make it very difficult for someone to break or brute force this hash. When a user signs in, you simply have to hash the attempted password again and check if the new hash and the stored hash are the same. The bcrypt library provides a great implementation of a hashing function that can be used for password hashing and comparison. But then these practices and guidelines and techniques tend to change over time as cybersecurity evolves, and you don't want to be left behind. You need to be on the lookout for when your implementation gets out of date and bring your apps and data along with you. Whew, we almost got through one of those points in there. I definitely don't have the time to get into others. Oh, looks like there's even more stuff in there that I didn't have there originally. But you probably have better things to do with your engineering time and effort. If you're using Next.js, you probably care more about building a great experience for your users rather than rolling your own infrastructure or webpack configs. Speaking of Next.js, it has its own expectations from your auth. The programming model and the infrastructure setup that Next.js provides is very different from a lot of other web frameworks. And while it comes with a lot of new capabilities, it also comes with some extra considerations on how to set up things like auth in the most optimal manner. There's a lot of places where you can put sensitive compute that needs to be behind an auth layer. You need to make authentication functionality and state available at all of these places to serve their specific use cases. You want to conditionally render client components, fetch user-specific data in server components, protect sensitive actions and routes, and you can put a lot of auth rules right in your edge middleware so that an unauthorized request can get rejected right away and doesn't even need to hit the rest of your application. Doing this requires understanding of a lot of the framework APIs available, how they work in different target environments, and how you can build your own APIs on top of the framework that are simple and solve the use case. Many auth solutions that you might be using today heavily favor the traditional stateful model within a single origin database. So you would have a single server or a cluster of servers sitting in a data center along with a database. And every time there's a request, the server checks the database for an active session and responds accordingly. This is at a mismatch with how Next.js works, because Next.js wants us to push compute closer to the users at the edge. This traditional model doesn't quite work here, and negates a lot of the benefits that edge compute provides. So we need to move away from this traditional model and push our auth to the edge as well. There's a couple ways to achieve that. JSON Web Tokens are a fantastic solution to achieve stateless auth, because once they are verified, we don't need to make a trip to the database to check for an active session. However, many JWT auth implementations swing too far the other way and completely lose the ability to keep track of sessions on the server. And we need those to be able to revoke an active session or to grant elevated permissions or simply to keep track of what devices are currently logged in. Short-lived tokens come in handy here, as they allow us to achieve stateless auth while retaining the ability to manage active sessions. And of course, we need to ensure we polyfill some of the crypto APIs that are needed for the JWT signing and verification so that we can work with the various edge runtimes. The other solution is to bring the data to the edge with us. And there's some great solutions to do that today. But this is additional infrastructure that you would need to manage and pay for, and the edge data space is not yet fully mature. And we still have the cost of making a full round trip to the database for every request. Once again, you probably have better things to do with your time than to reinvent authentication to fit into the Next.js framework, its programming model, and its edge setup. Let's switch gears and talk about the developer experience for a bit. If you're using Next.js, you likely care a lot about the developer experience. One of the best things about React and Next.js is that they offer a way to build great user experiences with simple and powerful APIs that are a delight to use. This is what developers have come to expect from their dev tools. When it comes to what exactly we are doing with DX, there's nothing new here. It's actually all the stuff that I already mentioned, just from the perspective of the developer trying to build these features or integrate them into the rest of the application. Both these scenarios can end up being a constant back and forth between the front end and the back end. You can only work on the front end UI for so long before you have to go to your back end team and ask for APIs, which probably require integrating with other third-party providers for sending emails or SMS or authenticator apps or checking a breach database and so on. And then they also have their own database tables to talk to. And once that's done, you can continue working on your UI. And then you need a consistent way to represent the current authenticated state in your code and have all the relevant data there. Has the user verified their email? Do they have multi-factor setup? What's their role in the current organization? Are they allowed to perform a sensitive action, or do they need to enter their password again? All these attributes will be used to make decisions about what features to allow or where to redirect the user. And your auth APIs need to handle all of that. Not to sound like a broken record, but you probably have better things to do than to write the same auth APIs that have been written a million times for various different projects that all basically do the same thing. Building a great DX for the core of your application should be your much higher priority. This is why Clerk exists. The goal of Clerk is to provide you with authentication that meets the expectations of your users, your frameworks, and your developers. Protecting your Next.js application with Clerk is as simple as using the built-in middleware. You can specify which pages should be accessible to users who are not signed in. And in those pages, you can simply drop our pre-built components that handle really all the authentication capabilities that I've mentioned in the previous slides, and more. The user profile and the organization profile components offer a complete self-service portal for your users to manage their account and org data. And of course, you can customize the components as you wish, or build your own with our React hooks. You can get the current auth state on the client with the use auth or use user hook, and on the server with the auth and the current user functions. You can check out our Next.js quick start guide and authenticate your Next.js application in a matter of minutes.